Good evening and welcome. Thank you for joining us on a Friday evening. I am the president of the Puget Sound Lawyer Chapter for the American Constitution Society for Law and Policy. ACS is founded on the principle that the law can and should be a force to improve the lives of all people. We promote positive change for shaping the debate on important legal issues and by building networks of lawyers, law students, judges, policymakers, and individual community members. ACS makes a difference in constitutional, legal, and public policy debates that shape our democracy. And you can learn more about our organization and the work we do both here and in Seattle and in the national community over at our table on the side. One of the many priorities that ACS has is promoting a vigorous right to vote and protecting that fundamental right to vote. We are proud to join with Town Hall Seattle to present this timely conversation, again, thinking that we are just wrapping up the local election season, and that has had some very significant implications in the Seattle area. On behalf of ACS, I am thrilled to introduce you to our special guests this evening. Ari Berman is a political correspondent for The Nation and an investigative journalism fellow for The Nation Institute. His stories have appeared in The New York Times, Rolling Stone, and The Guardian, and he is a frequent political commentator on MSNBC, C-SPAN, and NPR. There are lots of initials in that. His first book, Herding Donkeys, The Fight to Rebuild the Democratic Party and Reshape American Politics, was published in 2010 to widespread acclaim. And his latest book, Give Us the Ballot, available to my right, was named one of the 15 books you need to read this summer by The Village Voice and as a top nonfiction pick for summer by the Los Angeles Times. Mr. Berman is joined tonight by Washington State Supreme Court Justice Stephen Gonzalez. Justice Gonzalez was appointed to the Washington Supreme Court in 2012. Among other roles, he has served as a trial judge on the King County Superior Court and as an assistant U.S. attorney in the Western District of Washington. In 2011, Gonzalez helped secure prosecution for international terrorism case U.S. v. Rassam. For this, he received the Attorney General's Award for Distinguished Service and the Director's Award for the Superior Performance from the Department of Justice. These accompany numerous other awards in our local community, including Judge of the Year by Washington State Bar Association in 2012, and 2011, and the 2012 Difference Makers Award from the American Bar Association Solo, Small Firm, and General Practice Division. They're here tonight to discuss Mr. Berman's latest book, Give Us the Ballot, The Modern Struggle for Voting Rights in America. Please join me in offering up a warm welcome for Ari Berman and Justice Stephen Gonzalez.
Well, good evening. Thank you for the kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be here. If you haven't seen it yet, this is the book that we're talking about, Give Us the Ballot, which I had the pleasure to read in preparation for this discussion this evening. I wanted to start by saying that in this state we elect our judges, and that may be in part why I was asked to moderate this discussion. I've been on the ballot four times, twice in contested races and two times unopposed, at the county level and at the state level. Recently, there's been a discussion, which I suppose in some ways isn't new, about whether judges should be elected or appointed. Do you have an opinion on that topic?
I just asked you that this morning.
You did, but at this point, I'm the journalist. And
I told him I didn't want to see the questions in advance, and this is what happens. He turns the table on me. I think that justices should be appointed because I think it's unseemly for judges to have to raise money and campaign and make promises from people that they're supposed to then look impartially on when it comes to the law. But I think that those appointments maybe should not be life appointments. There are certain life appointments at the Supreme Court, for example, that I think may have not been such a great idea in retrospect. And so Norm Ornstein has a very interesting proposal that he would appoint Supreme Court justices for 18-year terms. And so they would serve a long time. They wouldn't be subject to political pressure, but they wouldn't be there forever either. And so I haven't really thought a whole lot about this in terms of the broad sweep of my book, but it's something to mull over for more discussion.
Well, one phrase about, sorry to focus on my own situation so much, but one of the things people say about electing judges is it's a right the people of Washington will never relinquish and never exercise. And I think what's meant by that is there's a huge drop-off on the ballot. People don't know who the judges are. There's no partisan symbol next to them in this state. Some states run partisan elections. How do we get people to, if we're going to continue to elect so many people, to pay attention to elections more? What are your ideas about making civics and elections more prominent in our discourse?
Well, I think first off, and this may run a little counterintuitive to the notion of more people participating, but I do think that we have too many elections and that we don't run our elections like we should. I think that the notion that you would vote in 2014, then you'd vote in 2015, and then you'd vote in 2016 is too much for people. And it was interesting to also see that Canadians were complaining that their election lasted 78 days. And that had just occurred when the Iowa caucus was just 100 days away. I mean, so our elections last forever. They're extremely expensive. There is a discussion in the media often of very frivolous issues and horse race coverage that dominates them, not to mention all of the barriers that people face, which I'm sure we're going to talk about in this discussion, which really is the focus of my book. But I think that if it's funny that the U.S. is the model for so much of the world in terms of exporting democracy, because I don't think any rational person would look at the U.S. election system right now and say, this is what we want to emulate.
Well, it sounds like you'd like to get to your book. So let's turn
I wrote
to
it
that.
For a reason.
Let's turn to that. Can you give us a thumbnail sketch of what the Voting Rights Act is and what it means?
Yeah, so the Voting Rights Act is really one of the most consequential pieces of legislation ever passed by the Congress. It's not just the most consequential piece of civil rights legislation, it's the most consequential piece of legislation in general in terms of what it did. And we had a situation before the Voting Rights Act where only 2% of African Americans were registered to vote in Selma, Alabama. Only 6.7% of African Americans were registered to vote in Mississippi. And so for all functional purposes, we had a system where an entire segment of the population and an entire region of the country was unable to vote and unable to cast a ballot. And we really were not a functioning democracy in any sense of the term. And so the Voting Rights Act changed that situation by doing a few things. The first thing is it struck down things like literacy tests and poll taxes and grandfather clauses and all-white primaries and all the related devices that had prevented people from being able to register to vote in the segregated South. And so when you went to vote in Selma, Alabama, for example, you no longer had to name all 67 county judges to be able to make it on the voting rolls. And that's something, as a judge, you might appreciate this. I doubt the judges themselves could have named all 66 of their colleagues.
And not everyone had to do that to register.
And it was a kind of thing where white voters never had to face these kind of literacy tests. This was something that was almost exclusively forced upon African Americans. So the Voting Rights Act got rid of those literacy tests and related devices. And then federal officials came to the South to register voters within days of the law passing. And you had a situation where hundreds and then thousands of people registered within days of the law's passage. So people really felt the power of the law immediately. And then federal officials stayed in the South to make sure that elections were not stolen. And over a longer period of time, what the Voting Rights Act did is it said to those states with the longest histories of voting discrimination that they had to approve their voting changes with the federal government to make sure they didn't discriminate in the future. And then it also gave the federal government the power to strike down discriminatory election systems across the country that prevented not just African Americans, but Hispanics, Asian Americans, Native Americans, other Native peoples from being able to be elected.
Now, some parts of the Voting Rights Act didn't apply to Washington, but applied to Alaska, for example. What was the rationale for covering a place like Alaska and not Washington State?
Well, so there was a formula in terms of which states had to approve their voting changes with the federal government, because the federal government knew where the problems were, but they couldn't just name Alabama, Mississippi, South Carolina as the places. That would have been unconstitutional. So they designed this formula, which is if there was less than 50% registered voters or voter turnout in the 1964 election, which if a state fit that criteria, it was very likely they had something like a literacy test or a poll tax that had disenfranchised a lot of people. Alaska had a lot of discrimination against the native population there, which I think is something that people don't realize, that the Voting Rights Act was initially aimed for good reason at the disenfranchisement of black Americans in the segregated South. But there were a lot of other people who were shut out of the political process. Hispanics in Texas, native populations in Alaska, Asian Americans in California. And all of them benefited from the Voting Rights Act as well.
Now, this was 1965 when the Voting Rights Act was passed. Did it immediately have an effect? Was there a delayed effect? And what was the reaction to the passage of the Voting Rights Act?
Well, it had an immediate effect in that things like literacy tests were abolished overnight, and there was a very large increase in voter registration. In Mississippi, for example, you had a situation where you had 6.7% of African Americans registered before the passage of the Voting Rights Act, and within a year you had 50% registered. So there was major, major increases in voter registration. And then over a period of time, we began to see people get elected for the first time. In the 1966 elections, you began to see the election of black sheriffs and black city council members. And in 1972, the first African Americans were elected from the South since Reconstruction. Andrew Young from Atlanta, who was one of Martin Luther King's top aides, and Barbara Jordan from Houston, Texas, two people who went on to be really super influential members of Congress. So there was a steady increase in terms of representation, that you began to see a lot of people be elected, not just African Americans, but the law was then expanded to encompass language minority groups, so you saw Hispanics and Asian Americans and Native Americans be elected as well. The law did have a backlash, though. I mean, it's certainly true that one of the consequences of the Voting Rights Act, and this wasn't just specific to the Voting Rights Act, it was also the Civil Rights Act and other pieces of legislation from the 1960s, what happened was a lot of conservative white Democrats became conservative white Republicans. And people like Strom Thurmond, the senator from South Carolina, who was very opposed to the Civil Rights Movement, they became power players in the Republican Party. And so you saw Richard Nixon have a Southern strategy, and then you saw a Southernization of the Republican Party become a lot more conservative and opposed to the Civil Rights Movement. So I think the Voting Rights Act democratized a lot of the country, and it made the South a lot more competitive. It laid the groundwork for people like Jimmy Carter and Bill Clinton to become president, and certainly Barack Obama. But it also is true that it led to a hardening of beliefs in the other party as well.
So you think it's led to some racial polarization? Is that a fair statement?
Well, I think in a way it led to a lot less racial polarization, in the sense that before the Voting Rights Act, you had no diversity in the Congress. And essentially the representation in this country was entirely white. And after the Voting Rights Act passed, you saw that there were African American members of Congress, there were Hispanic members of Congress, there were Asian representatives. And what we saw in many places in the country is that these people were elected in coalition. That when Andrew Young was first elected in Atlanta in 1972, he was elected from a district that was only about 30% African American. Now that was a rare situation, but it still happened. But it was true that over the years there became much more racial polarization. And now you have a situation in the South in particular where African Americans are identified as being with the Democratic Party, and Republicans and white voters are identified as being with the Republican Party, and there's not a whole lot of crossover.
Is there something wrong with a voter saying, I'm a woman, I want to vote for a woman candidate, I'm white, I want to vote for a white candidate, et cetera? Is there something wrong with that method of voting?
Well, I think it depends on how you're contextualizing it. If you're a woman and no women have been elected ever, and you want to vote for a woman candidate, I think that's perfectly justifiable. And what the Voting Rights Act was saying is that there were entire classes and races of people that had been shut out from the political process. So people justifiably, African Americans wanted to vote for an African American because they had no representation. Hispanics wanted to vote for Hispanics because they had no representation. Asian Americans wanted to vote for Asian Americans because they had no representation. But I think you also have to be open-minded about it. And what has happened so often in American history is people have voted for their own kind, particularly whites have voted to maintain white supremacy. And well, and so I think there's definitely something wrong with a white electorate that will refuse to vote for a candidate that doesn't look like them.
Well, certainly if that's the only criteria, it's a problem.
Yes.
Isn't it? Now, in response to the Voting Rights Act, or prior to it, didn't Mississippi elect by district, and did they change to, at large, or district, and did they change to at large afterwards? And can you explain why that might have happened?
Yeah, so one of the things that occurred after the Voting Rights Act was passed was the southern states immediately challenged the constitutionality of the law. And this went up before the Supreme Court. It was a two-day argument, one of the longest arguments in Supreme Court history. And the verdict came down on March 7th, 1966, which was the first anniversary of the Bloody Sunday March, when people, including Congressman John Lewis, were brutally beaten trying to march from Selma to Montgomery, which more than any other event led to the passage of the Voting Rights Act. And the Supreme Court upheld the constitutionality of the Voting Rights Act in an 8-1 decision. They basically said that the Voting Rights Act was meant to enforce the 15th Amendment of 1870. And as you well know, the 15th Amendment said very clearly that the right to vote shall not be denied or abridged on the basis of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. And for a brief period of Reconstruction, those words meant something. And we had black governors and senators from states like Louisiana and Mississippi, something that we never had seen since. But federal troops left after the disputed election of 1876, and we saw things like poll taxes and literacy tests and widespread violence and fraud, all of which led to Jim Crow. And the Voting Rights Act was meant to end that problem. So that's why the Supreme Court said it was constitutional. What happened after the Supreme Court upheld the constitutionality of the Voting Rights Act is states like Mississippi began to change their election systems. And they both gerrymandered districts, so it wasn't like they switched all of their elections. They just made it so that some elections were conducted in a way that an African-American candidate couldn't be elected. But they also switched to citywide or countywide elections. And what that meant is, in a place like Jackson, Mississippi, which was 60% white and 40% black, the 60% white majority could elect everybody. And in states like Mississippi, they refused to vote for an African-American candidate. So it meant that even after the passage of the Voting Rights Act, the representation was all white. And not just all white, but conservative white segregationists, not progressive whites who are reaching out to African-Americans. And that also went to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court in 1969 knocked down those kind of voting changes. And they said that the Voting Rights Act didn't just apply to voter registration, didn't just apply to the right to cast a ballot. It applied to everything relating to making a vote effective. And that was a very broad interpretation of the law. And the fight really shifted from registration to representation. And after the ruling was that these states had to submit their voting changes to the federal government, but these new kind of voting changes also would be blocked under the Voting Rights Act. That's when you really began to see so much of the country democratized for the first time.
And is that still the law of the land?
So that part of the law, Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act, which is that those states like Mississippi with the longest histories of voting discrimination have to approve their voting changes with the federal government, which was one of the things that 1969 decision said, that was rendered inoperative by the Supreme Court in the 2013 Shelby County versus Holder decision. They didn't get rid of the federal approval requirement. They got rid of the formula under which these states were covered.
And so I want to be clear, we're not talking about the Washington State Supreme Court here. We're talking about the U.S. Supreme Court.
We are not. I don't think the Washington State Supreme Court would have had the same finding. And so what that means is that, functionally speaking, no states have to approve their voting changes with the federal government anymore.
So what do you think that means for the future of enforcing the right to vote?
Well, I can tell you what it's meant in practice so far. What has occurred since this Shelby County decision in 2013 is that laws that were blocked as discriminatory under the Voting Rights Act, such as Texas's strict voter ID law, were allowed to go into effect. In Texas, 600,000 registered voters, which is about 5% of the electorate, don't have strict forms of government-issued ID. The law is written in such a way that you can vote with a handgun permit, but not a state university-issued ID. And that blacks, Hispanics, lower-income voters are disproportionately less likely not only to have this ID, but less likely to have access to underlying documents, like a birth certificate needed to get the ID. Not only that, but a third of counties in Texas don't even have a DMV office. So if you live in rural Texas and you don't drive or you have an expired driver's license, how are you supposed to get to an adjoining county? So that was the first thing that occurred after that decision. The second thing that occurred is that states passed more sweeping voting restrictions, that North Carolina essentially repealed or curtailed all of its voting reforms in that state. So North Carolina actually had really good election laws, and the state cut back on early voting. They eliminated same-day voter registration, the ability to show up, register, and vote at the same time.
And before, if that change had been proposed, it would have had to get clearance from the Department of Justice before it could be
implemented. Or the federal courts, or a three-judge federal court in Washington. And so that's how Texas's voter ID law was blocked.
But without Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act, is there no other way to challenge these practices? Or
there is. I just want to finish in terms of what I wasn't done describing the litany of voter suppression following. So, North Carolina, they cut back all of these reforms. They eliminated pre-registration for 16 and 17-year-olds, which was taught in high school civics classes. And this is a civics lecture. I think it's important to mention that. And we've just seen recently that Alabama passed a strict voter ID law. And then they just shut down 31 DMVs in the state where you need to go get that ID, including in many majority black counties. And so those are the kind of things that we've seen, and these are all things that would have had to been approved with the federal government. So now there's another part of the Voting Rights Act, Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act. I don't like when I talk too much about sections because this isn't a law school seminar, but just in terms of briefly describing Section 2 is that Section 2 is nationwide, so it can be used everywhere. It was just used recently in Yakima to elect the first Latino city council member. So it has the benefit of being nationwide and applying to everywhere. The problem with Section 2 lawsuits is that the burden of proof is on the people filing the lawsuits, the plaintiffs, to show discrimination. These are lengthy lawsuits. They're very expensive. They take a long time to win. And a lot of times, bad laws are in place, and then you have to challenge them. And what Section 5 did is it blocked laws before they even took effect. And they put the burden of proof on those states with a history of discrimination to prove that their laws were not discriminatory. So there are still remedies under the Voting Rights Act, but it's greatly weakened compared to what it was before.
Now, Section 5 never applied here in this state, though, so that never would have been a remedy here at all. And what happened in Yakima that you've just alluded to is, I think it was Judge Rice in federal court, said that there had been a pattern of exclusion of Latinos from elected office, and so changed it from at-large elections to district elections, correct?
Yes.
And resulted in the first Latinas in this case, ever being elected there.
Yeah.
But we've seen the same thing happen in Seattle. I mean, Seattle had never had a Latino or Latina elected to city council before either.
Mm-hmm.
Why did it take so long in Seattle as well?
Well, I think what we're seeing, and this is why the Voting Rights Act has been so valuable over the years, is it takes a long time for historically marginalized groups to exercise their political power, that it's something that just doesn't happen overnight. And in a place like Seattle, it could be that the changing demographics were a factor.
Well, Seattle also just changed to district elections from at-large as well, so it doesn't just apply necessarily to places where there's been a long history of strife, does it?
Yeah, no, it doesn't. And I think that's a really important point, that the Voting Rights Act and the method of election matters a lot, not just in the South, that it has mattered all across the country, and that there are places that you'd think of as very progressive that still have a long way to go towards representation.
Now, there are two young men in the audience, Asim and Isaac, who in a few years will be able to drive and then after that be able to vote. What is their path to becoming informed citizens who can really participate in democracy? What advice do you have for their generation?
Well, I think they need to read my book first. I could give them one single piece of advice. I think that
they're right.
It was really interesting to me because I finished basically reporting my book when the film Selma came out. And so I had been engrossed in this history, and one of the things that I really wanted to do with my book was tell the history of what happened after 1965. So tell the history of what happened after the passage of the Voting Rights Act, because there had been so much documentation of the events that led to the passage of the Voting Rights Act, the brutal beating of so many peaceful, unarmed demonstrators in Selma.
In fact, you started your book on the Edmund Pettus Bridge.
On the 50th anniversary of the Bloody Sunday March with President Obama and Congressman John Lewis and 60,000 people going to Selma this past March. But I thought it was critically important to talk about what happened after Selma, because people know about Selma, or you think people know about Selma. But what was interesting to me about the reaction to Selma was that so many people, particularly younger people, didn't even know about Bloody Sunday. Mm-hmm. So they didn't even know that there had been so much violence inflicted on people like John Lewis, and that someone like John Lewis walks around every single day bearing the scars of Bloody Sunday. And this didn't happen that long ago, but there are people still alive today who went through this, and that this didn't happen in South Africa or Iraq. It happened right here in Alabama. And so that was an eye-opening experience for me, and I think Selma was an extremely useful educational tool for people to realize what people have gone through, the struggles, just to get this basic right to vote. And that it's something that we shouldn't take lightly, that because of what people like John Lewis went through, everybody has the right to participate. And it's something that I think we take for granted so often because we aren't aware of our own history. We're not aware that in 1787, when the Constitution was ratified, only white male property owners could vote. Or at the end of the Civil War, black men could only vote freely in five states. Or that in 1920, when women were given the right to vote, that was a right that almost exclusively applied to white women. So I think once you're aware of this history, you understand the weight of this responsibility, what the ballot means, and also why this has been such a contested fight, and that the vote really has power. And if it didn't have power, there wouldn't be such an effort throughout American history to try to restrict it.
I wanted to ask you another question about Washington State. Here we no longer have a polling place. You vote by mail. Everyone votes by mail. Does that system encourage informed participation, or does it have the opposite effect?
I think it. If you look at the turnout numbers, it encourages participation. You're more of an expert on Washington State than I am, so I'm going to ask you a question. In Washington State, can you drop your ballots at places, and are there a lot of places at which you can drop your ballot physically?
Yes to the first question, no to the second.
There's not a lot of places.
There are places, okay. But not a lot.
So there are people that are uncomfortable voting by mail, particularly, I know, in the South, a lot of people that grew up in segregation want to vote in person to know that their ballot is counted. There's also data that shows that absentee ballots that are cast from primarily urban, predominantly minority neighborhoods are less likely to be counted than from predominantly white neighborhoods. So there's a disparate racial impact in the counting of absentee ballots in certain places. I don't know if that's the case in Washington, but it's been the case in places like Florida as recently as in the last election.
Well, King County has a worse record counting absentee ballots than, for example, some adjoining counties.
I know my sister lives in Colorado, and Colorado has kind of adopted a fusion model of Washington, which is that they're moving to all-mail elections, and they sent her a ballot. So she didn't have to ask one, she got one. And then she was able to drop it at many, many locations. In Colorado, they have it at the public library, they have it at Walmarts. And I think that kind of system makes a lot of sense because you're not abolishing the ability to vote in person. You can still go down there and put your ballot in. But there's more options in terms of how we do it. I don't think that's the only remedy, though. I mean, I think there's other things that we could be doing. For example, even if you had vote by mail, you still have a situation where a quarter of Americans aren't even registered to vote. So what your neighbor Oregon has done, I'm a little afraid to bring this up, knowing the rivalry here, but what Oregon did is they became the first state to automatically register people who seek a driver's license or a state ID from the DMV. And then those voters can opt out if they want to, but otherwise they're registered.
So like these young men here, when they turn 16 and get driver's licenses, if they were in Oregon, they'd automatically be pre-registered, which would take effect in 2 years.
I don't know enough about the law to say if they would be pre-registered. I know if they're 18 and they're getting a driver's license, they will be automatically registered. And I think that's really interesting because in Oregon, it could lead to 300,000 new people registering. It's just been adopted by California. In California, it could lead to 6 million new people being registered, which is a huge number of people being registered. And you're talking about people that are disproportionately younger, disproportionately voters of color, who might not register otherwise. But I also think it's interesting because it's a way of thinking of the vote as a right and not a privilege, and saying that we're better off in a democracy when more people participate, and it's the responsibility of the state and the country to make sure that more people do so, which is not really the position that we've taken as a country throughout American history.
And moving again to another issue here locally, we've just, at least locally, passed some voucher system to publicly finance elections. What do you think about public financing of elections in general? And if you're in favor of it, what, in what form?
Well, I'm a big supporter of public financing of elections. I think that the endless money chase has had an extremely corrupting role on American politics. And I don't think you can talk about voting rights without talking about money in politics, and I don't think you can talk about money in politics without talking about voting rights, because I think if you look at the Supreme Court's Shelby County decision in 2013 that we talked about, and then the Citizens United decision, which meant that you can raise unlimited sums of money, often in secret, those go hand in hand. It's an attempt to try to give the most powerful and the most affluent people in society even more power and give everyone else less of a voice. So I think that public financing makes a lot of sense. Many, many countries have publicly financed elections. They also have robust public media that reports substantively on the elections. They have much shorter windows in terms of how long the elections take place, so there really can be a discussion of substantive issues during that time when people are paying attention. I think Seattle is going to be a very, very interesting experiment. And now, my understanding is every voter gets $100, right, to spend how they like on a candidate. This has been something that reformers have been trying to push for 20 years. And what we're seeing is that in the absence of any action by the Congress, in the face of a hostile Supreme Court, that states and cities are becoming the laboratories of change. Seattle's doing it with public financing, Oregon's doing it with voting rights, and I think if these things work well, they're going to be adopted in a lot more places.
I want to read a quote that is in your book. Earl Warren wrote that we need to, quote, shift the advantage of time and inertia from the perpetrators of evil to its victims. What did Earl Warren mean with those words?
So Earl Warren was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in the 1960s. And what he meant is that before 1965, when the Justice Department wanted to strike down a literacy test in a place like Selma, they had to analyze 36,000 pages of voter registration records. The litigation averaged 2.5 years, and they were dealing with an often hostile judiciary in which the judges had been appointed by conservative segregationist Southerners. So even after they had analyzed 36,000 pages of voter registration records, they then had to go before this hostile judiciary that would often not rule in their favor. And what that meant is that the states that were doing the discriminating, they had all the advantages. They had all the built-in advantages. And the Voting Rights Act was going to shift it so that now Alabama had the burden of proving that a voting change was not discriminatory, and that now Alabama no longer could have a literacy test. And so all of the built-in mechanisms in the system that had been weighted against those voters that were facing discrimination were put on the states themselves, because what had occurred is that since the end of Reconstruction, the states had ignored the 15th Amendment, and they had ignored so many other protections for voting rights, and that's why the Voting Rights Act was so necessary, and that's why it ultimately was so successful, because it not only got rid of these mechanisms that had prevented people from voting, but it was structured in such a way to ensure compliance from the states. And this one part of the law that the Supreme Court rendered inoperative had blocked 3,000 discriminatory voting changes from 1965 to 2013.
Now, states can pass their own version of a Voting Rights Act. It doesn't have to be a national one, isn't that true?
Yeah.
And how many states have something like that?
California, to my knowledge, is the only state that has a Voting Rights Act, and there's a proposal in Washington State to do so.
And how successful has the act in California been in preventing the sorts of things that you've identified?
Well, the California law is fairly specific. Basically, what it says is that when there are at-large, so countywide or citywide elections, in places where there's a long history of racially polarized voting, so you know, whites, for example, refusing to vote for a black or Hispanic candidate, that they need to switch to district-based elections. And it's been quite successful in California, and there have been proposals to expand it as well. It's not a replacement for the Voting Rights Act, the Federal Voting Rights Act, because it doesn't apply federally. But it has been important in states, and it's another way in which states are thinking about how to think innovatively and become laboratories of innovation.
Is there anything that I haven't asked that you really wanted to tell this audience that I just haven't prompted you about so far?
Well, I just wanted to talk about a little bit how I got into this subject matter in the first place, which usually is the first question I'm asked, but in this case it will be the last question that I talk about. So this was not something that I always was super passionate about, or it wasn't necessarily always my calling. I did not grow up in the segregated South. My parents did not meet marching in Selma, and I think, like a lot of people, I kind of took the Voting Rights Act and these sort of things for granted, and I thought that I knew there was a civil rights movement in the 1960s. I knew that a lot of amazing things had happened, but like many people, I kind of thought these battles had been settled. Mm-hmm. And what caught my eye was that following the 2010 election, when so many states either flipped from blue to red or became a whole lot redder, we started to see a wave of new efforts to restrict access to the ballot. Things like shutting down voter registration drives and cutting back early voting and requiring strict forms of ID to cast a ballot and purging the voting rolls and disenfranchising ex-felons. And there was just a tremendous acceleration of these efforts. From 2011 to 2012, there were 180 new voting restrictions introduced in 41 states. And half the states in the country passed laws making it harder to vote. Not Washington, luckily. But what was so remarkable about this was it wasn't just happening in Georgia and Alabama and Mississippi in the old Confederacy. It was happening in Ohio and Iowa and Wisconsin and Pennsylvania, states that did not have the same history of voting discrimination. And it seemed to me like a clear attempt following Barack Obama's election to try to make the electorate older, whiter, and more conservative, as opposed to younger, more progressive, and more diverse. And instead of having more people participate, have fewer people participate. And so this was a really eye-opening development for me, and it was also a political story that no one was covering. So I wrote about it first for Rolling Stone, and then I wrote about it for The Nation, and I really followed the subject of voting rights all the way through the 2012 election. And then after the 2012 election, the Supreme Court heard this challenge to the Voting Rights Act that we've been discussing, and I became very interested in the history of the Voting Rights Act. And that's when I decided to write my book, because I knew, as I said earlier, that there had been so much written about what led to 1965, but there had been so little written about what happened after 1965. And this was relevant because this year is not just the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act, but we're in a whole new struggle over voting rights. So it's something that's very, very relevant to the debates of today. So I knew that I would have a book that was both hopefully a history that would hold up in 5 to 10 years, but also something that I felt would be really important in terms of the current dialogue, the current debate. And the 2016 election is going to be the first presidential election in 50 years without the full protections of the Voting Rights Act. And so I think this is going to be a very big story in the next election.
What do you think our voting turnout is going to be like in 2016? Do you have a prediction about, well, let me ask, what has it been traditionally for presidential year elections nationwide, and what do you think it's going to look like in the future?
Well, I mean, at the very best, we have 60% voter turnout in presidential elections, and that's at the best. We often are 50, 55%. In midterm elections, we're much lower. In the last midterm election in 2014, we had the lowest voter turnout since World War II. And what I saw, and you never can draw a direct correlation between laws and turnout, because there's a lot of different factors there. But what I saw in 2014 was this was the first presidential election since the first election period since the Supreme Court's decision. I saw that there were many voters who were turned away from the polls in states like Texas and North Carolina because of these restrictions. And they were turned away for no good reason. There was no evidence of voter fraud to justify these measures. And I think that's another important thing to talk about, because the way that these laws have been sold is that there's rampant voter fraud occurring, and that you need to show some sort of ID or something like that to be able to counteract the fraud. And it's important to note that this would only stop one kind of fraud, which is in-person voter impersonation. And that kind of fraud is incredibly rare. There have been 1 billion votes cast since 2000, but only 31 credible cases of voter impersonation. And in a state like Texas, you're more likely to be struck by lightning than you are to impersonate another voter at the polls. And we have enough problems just trying to get someone to vote once in this country. The idea that they would vote multiple times is a little hard to comprehend.
And of course, I want to make a quick plug for those of you who vote for judges. Three members of the Supreme Court are going to be up for election next year. There are 9 of us, and we have 6-year terms, and so every 2 years, 3 are up. And if you want to learn about how to vote for judges, there's a good website called votingforjudges.org. It doesn't tell you who to vote for. It just puts up the judges' qualifications, and you get to make your own choice. But you only have to go to one place to research judges, votingforjudges.org, and I urge you to look there when you're choosing the judge, because if you don't know who to vote for, leaving it blank is better. We don't want you guessing, right? But I would really urge you to do that. And one thing about voting by mail is that you have the time to do that. You have that ballot in your hands for days. You can do your research and think carefully about it.
And one thing I will say is that local races have become really critical in this struggle. It was state legislatures across the country that passed all of these new voting restrictions. It was courts, both state courts like yourself and federal courts, that have ruled on so many of these issues. And so the composition of the courts, the composition of state legislatures matters incredibly. We have a situation now where we have an extremely conservative Supreme Court on civil rights matters, notwithstanding gay marriage, where Anthony Kennedy has been more progressive, but on other issues, very conservative. We have a Congress that's paralyzed by inaction. So the states are where the battles are right now. The states are either restricting voting rights or they're becoming laboratories of innovation to expand voting rights. But this work is happening at the local level. So these local races are very important if you care about these issues.
Now, for your book, I know that there are some available here. For folks who don't get them tonight, how do they find your book?
Well, the easiest answer is they should get them tonight. In this day and age, they can find it everywhere. I mean, they should buy it locally at a local bookstore. Not at the new Amazon store, but they should, there's a bunch of really great bookstores in Seattle. I was just at the University Bookstore, which is selling books. I got some wonderful Pacific Northwest themed books for my 1-year-old daughter, and Elliott Bay and many other bookstores here are great, and I'm sure they have copies. Failing that, you could order it online, and it's available on all the online places. It's also available on Kindle, and it's also available on audiobook if you have a 9-hour flight coming up. You can listen to the whole thing.
Now, I promised time for questions, and we're at that point.
Hi, Joan Lawson, and I've been with the League of Women Voters for a while. And we make it very easy to register to vote in our area and easy to vote. But voting has gone down because people lose their ballots. How do you think we can encourage people to actually mail their ballots in?
Ideas about way to encourage participation when you get it in the mail and not just
do
put
you,
it in the stack.
Well, do you have any ideas? I don't live in a vote-by-mail state, so it's not something that is as big of a problem in a state like New York. So do you have any ideas living here?
I have a few ideas. I think it's critical, of course, that we publish voters' pamphlets and that they're easy to find and informative. And I think it's great when you have voting gatherings where your admission to that gathering is your filled-out ballot that you then put in a box. And I think if we have fun that way. Another way is to do something akin to a book club, but you're having a voters' pamphlet club where you all come together, you each have an assignment for reading about one candidate or one initiative, and your job is to report to your friends and neighbors at that meeting about what you think about that initiative or that candidate and make a recommendation. I think that kind of discussion is key to a functioning democracy and to civics working. Those are some of my ideas.
No. Next question.
Hi, John Carter, and I have a question. Concerning this election we just had, I was surprised to learn that in the state of Pennsylvania, they just had a really important election that concerned three Supreme Court positions. And the reason it was such an important election is it was about the issue of gerrymandering. Pennsylvania has been harshly gerrymandered by the Republicans. And
yep.
I was a little stunned to find out that the party of the judges was going to make a difference about the gerrymandering. And this is, you know, this is an issue nationwide. They politicians are picking the voters instead of the voters picking the politicians, is what they're saying. And so my question, and I'm asking this because I have a daughter living in Pennsylvania now, and she's an executive director of a public interest nonprofit that works on issues like this, and I want to sound smart next time I talk to her, so help me out here. If an activist group were to devise a strategy that could even go nationwide to states to try to reform and rectify the gerrymandering problem, what recommendations would you have to devise a winning strategy?
Well, I don't think that politicians should be drawing their own districts, period. I mean, because it's driven by self-interest, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican. And so I think that we need to have independent commissions or nonpartisan commissions draw the districts. And so that it doesn't just benefit one party or another. And you have extremely gerrymandered districts on the Democratic side, and you have extremely gerrymandered districts on the Republican side. You have many more gerrymandered Republican districts now because they control so many more states. There are, I think, something like, I forget the exact numbers, but Republicans control about three times as many states as Democrats do right now. And so they've gerrymandered places like Pennsylvania like crazy. And Pennsylvania was a state that Barack Obama won twice. But of the 18 elected representatives in Pennsylvania, 13 are Republicans. So Democrats only have 5 of 18 seats in Congress, even though President Obama won that state twice. And I think there's a problem when the Congress has a 10% approval rating, but 90% of members of Congress are reelected. So something doesn't fit there, and I think we need to try to figure out a way to take the politics out of redistricting.
Thank you.
Yeah, you just brought some of the biggest issues with districts. Sometimes it doesn't lead to good results.
Yeah.
Yet we see districts are the only alternative that are proffered when we want to elect minorities as versus at large. We have one or two options, districts and at large. But I happen to be a mathematician who specializes in voting methods, and I know there are many other methods, including methods of, for example, proportional representation where you rank candidates, where you actually could get minorities represented even at large. For example, if there were 25% Latinos in a population, you could get 25% of your city council elected as Latinos, even without large elections, if you can rank candidates, and so that if Latinos rank certain candidates high, they get elected, you see.
Yeah.
And have those kind of methods been ever considered anywhere?
Yes. I believe the city of Oakland now has that method of ranked choice voting for mayoral elections, and it's led to a very different kind of candidates being elected. So some places are experimenting with it, and it's definitely an interesting idea.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think the two young men were in line before you were, so if you don't mind being patient, we'll ask their questions, and then we'll turn to you. This is an example of favoritism, by the way.
They may or may not be related to you.
So you had said that before the Voting Rights Act, African Americans had to take literacy tests, right? So why exactly do you think that white people at the time thought that foreigners, including Asian Americans, Hispanics, everybody, why necessarily they were bad? Like, they had to take those types of tests.
Hmm. That's an interesting question. Well, I think that basically there's always been a contradiction in our country between the fact that we said all men are created equal, but we didn't structure our laws to reflect that. That at the very founding of the Republic, only white male property owners could vote. And so the founders made a very deliberate decision. It wasn't like they didn't discuss it. They made a very deliberate decision that they were going to exclude certain people. and that that was a way that they were going to be able to retain their own power. And the vote has been the way that people have retained their own power historically. And so those in power have tried to create a system to remain in power. And there have always been fear of one group or another that they will threaten the power of those that are in charge. And so in the segregated South, for example, many whites viewed African Americans as a threat. They view them as a threat to their political power, to the economic power, to the social order. But it wasn't exclusive to African Americans. You saw discrimination against Irish Americans when they came over in New York, Italian Americans. You saw discrimination against Asian Americans in California. You saw discrimination against Hispanics in Texas. And so while we like to think of ourselves as this incredible melting pot, and in many ways we are, I think that is one of our greatest characteristics, in terms of how we've structured our government, we've always structured it in such a way to try to keep people from participating instead of bringing them in. And I think what the Voting Rights Act tried to do was it tried to make real those words of equality, that all men are created equal, that were in the Declaration of Independence that we ignored for so long. And when Lyndon Johnson introduced the Voting Rights Act, and I'd urge people that are interested in this issue to watch the speech that he gave to members of Congress, he really gave a moral appeal about the importance of voting rights. And he said it's wrong, deadly wrong, to prevent any of your fellow Americans the right to vote. So he phrased it as a right that everyone should enjoy, and something that when we all didn't enjoy it, we were all worse off because of it.
And of course, when we said all men are created equal, we left women out. That was a mistake.
Yes, and that too.
Took us many years to remedy. 1920 nationwide, we were 10 years ahead of that here in Washington, Washington State. Thank you for your question.
Very good question.
Did you have a question? All right, fair enough. Sir.
No, it's okay. without the Voting Rights Act, what's to prevent these states from going back to literacy tests, and are there any legal grounds for lawsuits against some of these draconian practices? Or
well, they can still be sued under the existing parts of the Voting Rights Act. So as we mentioned, that those states with a long history of voting discrimination, they no longer have to approve their voting changes with the federal government, but they can still be sued under Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act, and that's what has occurred in Texas and North Carolina, and has also led to successful litigation in Yakima and a lot of other places. The problem is that those lawsuits are expensive, and they are difficult to win, and they require a tremendous amount of organization. And those people that are facing disenfranchisement don't usually have the political power to fund these lawsuits, to organize them. So people have to step in, either the federal government or local civil rights groups, whether it's the ACLU or the NAACP or the Brennan Center for Justice. There's a lot of good groups, League of Women Voters, there's a lot of good groups working on this issue that I would urge you to check out. So it's not like all is lost, it's just become more difficult. And I think that states feel like this is something that they can get away with more than they could previously. And so it requires a lot of vigilance, not just on the state level, but it requires a lot of vigilance on on the local level as well. The one thing that was slightly encouraging is that when Alabama closed all these DMV offices, there was a big national outcry. And a lot of people seem to get very worked up about the issue, because whether or not you're pro or con voter ID laws, you can't really justify closing the very offices where people need to go get the ID. And so that's something that even supporters of the law would have a hard time justifying. So I think there is more attention on this issue. People are paying attention more, but it's not getting nearly enough coverage as it should.
I'm curious what you both think of top two primaries.
That's also a lot of interesting, innovative questions in this audience. You guys are very smart. That's also been adopted in California. So instead of having a Republican and Democratic primary, the top two people face off against each other. And the idea is that it'll create less far-right candidates and fewer far-left candidates, and there'll be more incentive for people to try to run to the middle. I think it's had mixed success so far in California. It hasn't transformed the system, but I think it's a positive. I think it's a positive development and another potential solution.
To me, this is the most important question. The most important thing going on in America today is that people are not registering and they're not voting. And it was interesting that you mentioned the shift has to come from making it, it's not so much that you're registering, it's that you're being represented. And I'm wondering if anyone that you know of is trying to make, for people who aren't interested in registering, trying to make it more sexy in some way. You have to get, no, but I mean, you have to get public yeah. figures who are really well known, whether it's a sports figure
yeah.
or a pop star or whatever. It has to be made cool to vote again.
Yeah.
And there's many ways to go about this, but the fact that so few people voted in the last election is just astonishing me to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there has to be some way, I think high school teachers especially have to tell the kids when they're sophomores or juniors, look at this wonderful right you have. They have to stress it.
I think
really
that's a great question. Do you have ideas about how to encourage people to register and vote?
Well, I mean, I think that just getting them registered is a positive step. That's why I think what's happening in Oregon and California is interesting, because there are people that for one reason or another are shut out from the political process. And if they're then registered, you can at least focus on getting them to vote as opposed to spending all this time just trying to get them registered. And we have huge problems with the amount of people that are unregistered. I think that the laws do matter, though, that if, for example, states that have same-day voter registration have voter turnouts of up to 5 to 10% higher than states that don't. And states that have voter ID laws have turnouts of up to 5 to 10% lower than states that don't. So you're talking about big swings in the electorate just depending on what the law is. Now, that's not going to solve all of the problems. I think that people need to see a link between the issues they care about and that voting will do something about it. Because I think there are a lot of people that care about climate change and a lot of people that care about mass incarceration and what's happening with the police in this country and a lot of people that care about a women's right to choose and economic justice and all these other issues. And they have to see that voting will help solve those problems.
Could you talk a little bit about the Voter Rights Advancement Act that's being proposed in Congress by Democrats? And I believe Lisa Murkowski
yeah.
has co-sponsored that, but yeah. does that have any chance?
Yeah, so there is legislation in Congress called the Voting Rights Advancement Act that's been sponsored by John Lewis, and it has bipartisan support with Senator Lisa Murkowski of Alaska, and it would restore the provision of the Voting Rights Act that has been struck down based on more current data of voter disenfranchisement and discrimination. It doesn't have much of a chance of passing in this Congress, but I think that the point is to try to lay the groundwork for passage in future Congresses, and that if we had a different composition of our elected officials, this thing could happen. And also just for people to know that there is a solution out here, so they're not just despondent about what's going on, that they realize that there are innovative solutions, whether it's restoring the Voting Rights Act or it's automatic registration. There's a lot we could do. We're not lacking good ideas. We're lacking the political will to implement them.
I want you all to join me in thanking Ari Berman for coming to speak with us tonight.